I would like just to say at the beginning that I am very pleased to be part of this project. I have a profound admiration for the tradition of math education here in Hungary. And making this tradition more understandable and better disseminated in the international world, I think it's something which is necessary. And I am very pleased to participate a bit in this enterprise as a critical friend. And also, as I have learned during my contact with the leaders of the two projects I am in charge of, I see also that this tradition is not necessarily well represented and disseminated in Hungary itself, in ordinary public school in Hungary. So I think that, as you said, Andreas, a moment ago, having both the research and the development, the research and the implementation at school and developing the resources is something which is really at the same time challenging and very important for Hungary and for the whole world. So I have been asked to speak about some lessons from European projects on STEM education. And in the last decade, I have been part of several of these projects as a scientific expert. And so I have learned from this project. And it shows that I am happy to try to share some lessons from this project with you. So first I will present the European context and my personal experience of it. And then I will try to express some lessons from this project. And I will focus in the time, reduced time of the lecture. I have decided to focus on four main topics. First, the meaning of inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education itself. Then dissemination strategies. Then assessment practices, and more briefly, certainly, interdisciplinarity, world of work, cultural diversity, and inclusion were the theme of the most recent projects. And then I will end by some final comments. So the European context. In fact, there is a shared concern, and it is seen also in the description of the projects, the fact that it is very important for Europe of maintaining its scientific competitiveness. And there is a risk resulting from the observed disaffection for scientific careers in most countries in Europe. And so at the beginning, there was a mobilization of the Academy of Science, leading to the founding of a few projects, the Project Pollen, the Project Sinus project. And then the European Commission asked some experts, led by Michel Rocard, a politician, to write a report. And this was the Rocard Report, known as the Rocard Report, published in 2007. And this report highlights the negative impact of teaching methods in math and science that it is too much formal and deductive. It proposed to look for solutions through the promotion and generalization of inquiry-based method in science, education, and problem-solving in math. At that time, there is a distinction between the two in the language. And it asks also for a strong financial support from Europe for that, for projects pursuing such goals as the image of the first project, Pollen and Sinus. And this was, if you look at the second recommendation of the Rocard's report, it is written, improvement in science education should be brought about through new forms of pedagogy. The introduction of inquiry-based approaches in school, actions for teacher training to IBSE, and the development of teachers' networks should be actively promoted and supported. And this was the basis from different courses. From that time, there was a diversity of projects with very different types of projects. Projects from the framework program of Europe 7, for instance, but also Erasmus Plus project, Comenius project, a lot of projects. And in order to have a vision of this project, you can go to the scientific, web portal where all these projects have registered. And you can look for Hungary and look what projects Hungary has been included, has been a partner since the beginning of these actions. And there are a lot of projects with Hungary. For my part, I began to work in this project in 2009-2010 with two different projects, but from the same framework program. And the first was the Fibonacci project, which was co-leaded by La Mer La Patte in France and the École Normale Supérieure, and by Rutte University with Peter Baptiste. And who had developed the sinus and the sinus transfer project. And also a second project, which was the PRIMAS project, which was led by Katia Maas from the University of Freiburg. And these were very huge projects. For instance, in the first project at the beginning, there was for Fibonacci 25 institutions, international institutions, and in PRIMAS there were 14 countries, 17 institutions, so they were very big projects. And the ambition to the large-scale dissemination of inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education in this project, and to find dissemination strategies for that. And then I was involved in other projects. For instance, the first was MASKIL, and MASKIL was in some sense following up of the PRIMAS project. The two first projects was acknowledged by the European Commission as very successful projects. And MASKIL was founded then. And MASKIL was more devoted to connecting with the world of work, inquiry-based e-learning and inquiry-based education, and also extending to vocational school. Because in the first project, there were essentially general schools, high schools, and primary schools. The second was ASSISMI. ASSISMI was a smaller project led by the University of Copenhagen, but it was more a research project than a dissemination project. And it was focusing on evaluation, because evaluation assessment was seen as a huge obstacle to the dissemination of inquiry-based education in the most countries. And then the last one is the MASDIF project. Both MASKIL and MASDIF are led by Katia Maas still. She is very successful in getting European projects. And MASDIF is more oriented toward taking into account making IBL a support for inclusion and learning in multicultural context, and taking in charge diversity in classroom, any kind of diversity. So you see there are different kinds of projects. Even in my experience, it's a very limited experience of all these projects, but even within these five projects, you see the diversity of perspective, and at the same time, some continuity. So some characteristics of all these projects. Of course, they have an inclusive vision of math and science education. The goal is to pursue quality mathematics and science education for all students, not just for the gifted. And there is also the involvement of a diversity of factors beyond the school environment, because they consider that it is absolutely necessary if we want to disseminate widely inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education. And the idea that we have to build sustainable relationship between these different actors. There is also a focus on teacher preparation and professional development, which is seen as a key lever in order to progress in that direction. And the building of networks and communities around inquiry-based science education and inquiry-based math education at local, national, and international levels, and the sharing of resources. There is also the importance we teach attached to the production of resources, both for teachers and classroom, but also for teacher educators and for the training of teachers. And to the fact that resources have to be adapted to different contexts. And they have also to be adapted to different languages, because in this European project, there is not only one language. And Scientix is helping a lot for the translation of the resource between different languages. There is also an importance attached to a better connection between math and science education, and most of these projects are STEM regard STEM education, and more STEAM education, including arts, in the picture. With the last one of the last European report dating from 2016, and is not reserved to secondary education, inquiry-based learning, inquiry-based education. There is a strong focus in with partners who work in primary education and even for kindergarten in order to start very early inquiry-based education in math and science. And especially, I would say, in science, because the teaching of science in many countries is underdeveloped at primary level, while math is taught in all primary school in the world. So I come to some lessons from this project. And for me, something that, as an expert, and an advisor for this project, what was striking at the beginning is that reading the calls, the proposals, you had the feeling that people agreed on the meaning they gave to inquiry-based education, inquiry-based learning. And in fact, both in the Fibonacci and in the Primas project, we spent a lot of time during the 4 years of the project in order to come to an agreement regarding what we exactly mean by inquiry-based learning, inquiry-based education in math, in science. And are they the same thing in math and science, or are they different in what ways? And the answer, which is also interesting, is that the answers were different from one project to another. So for instance, in the Fibonacci project, the advisory team, the scientific advisory team, was charged especially to reflect on these issues and to reflect on also on the similarities and differences between inquiry-based learning in math and science. And for the scientific part, the main inspirators were Justin Dillion and Wynn Arlen. I think that perhaps some of you who are in science certainly know about these persons, which are well known in the field. And so I have reproduced, it's just a glimpse, I have reproduced the schema, but a schema without a discourse is nearly nothing. But I would like to insist of this is a schema of how they present inquiry-based learning in science, starting from questions, envisaging possible explanations leading to prediction, then plan, conduct investigation, interpret the data collect, conclude, and then the fact that this is not a linear process. It is emphasized in the discourse. So this is more a cyclic process. And generally, the interpretation of data leads to come back to the prediction, leads to come back to possible explanations, and even leads to come back to new questions. And there is also what you see here on the right part, the fact that generally you need to make alternative ideas enter the scene, and not just the spontaneous student's idea in order to explain phenomena. And these alternative ideas do not necessarily come just from the students. And here, the role of the teacher is very important. And the fact that we do not think about isolated situation. You think about situation and problem and questions that can make ideas, local ideas, progress towards the big ideas of science. And for instance, Wynne Arlen, Pierre Lena, and others have written something, a booklet about within the Fibonacci project, with about the 10 big ideas for science. And I think that I see some connection with Vargas' vision and the fact that this epistemology is important and that your education goes toward big ideas and not just solving particular problems. We reflected about IBL in mathematics, and in the long discussion you have during the 4 years of the project with between us, of course there was the acknowledgement of strong similarities with scientific inquiry, as is usually described, if we take into account the fact that it is not a linear process and this progression with big ideas. But for us, it was very important to point out some differences that make the epistemology of mathematics specific. First, the double source of question. In math, our question may come from the natural world, from daily life, from the society, but they also come from the mathematics themselves. And the progression of mathematics is linked both to external and internal questions. And our students have to experience both. And both contribute to the progression toward big ideas in math. Also, the fact that in math, experimentation, if you see that, if we consider that math, as in this project we consider as an experimental dimension, it's not a pure deductive science, experimentation has a diversity of roles in math, because experimentation leads to formulating conjecture, but it also leads to test conjectures. It also can be used in order to give ideas for proofs. So it is not exactly the same status of experimentation in math in science. And for us, it was important to make this clear. Another point was that we see mathematics as a highly connected, accumulative discipline, perhaps much more than physics or science, life science, maybe. And this creates specific obligation for the development of inquiry-based education in math. And last point, but essential point, the specific form of that validation text in math in terms of mathematical proofs that lead to a apodictic assertion that makes that experiment is no longer necessary, that experiment cannot destroy what has been proved mathematically. And this makes a great difference with science. And this was the vision of Fibonacci. If we look at the vision, which is synthesized here, is the vision proposed, the agreement in Primas. And it shows that the vision is totally different. I would say the vision in Fibonacci was led by epistemological questions. The vision in Primas is led by pedagogical concerns. What Primas tried to capture was a sort of inquiry-based pedagogical culture in the classroom. So you see that the structure is different. You have five different things, five dimensions organizing this culture with the type of questions. But in the type of question, I have to struggle a lot in order to be sure, and the question scientifically relevant would be really there. Because what was the most important for many partners was that the question were experienced as Swedes. As three questions. Huh? And what students do, the classroom culture, you see value mistakes, the student contribution, dialogic, share ownership, all these characteristics, the valued outcomes, the teacher guidance. You have this description, which is quite different from the previous one, but which is also interesting in order to understand what is inquiry-based education. Finally, from this, all this, it attracted our intention that, and I worked with Morten Blomage in this special, in an article published in this special issue of the journal International ZDM, which was more or less devoted, organized by Primas actors. And the fact that, in fact, if we look at math, the term of inquiry-based education is a term that has migrated towards mathematics, but originated in the world of science education. In math education, originally, we spoke more of problem solving. And it was also in the Rocard report. But when migrating in math education, it does not migrate in a void space. It migrates, the term migrates in something where for decades in different countries, researchers and teachers have tried to develop some forms of inquiry-based, what is called now inquiry-based education. But they didn't label it inquiry-based education. And what is interesting is to see that these different construction are culturally situated. What has been developed here in Hungary is not what has been developed in France. It's not what has been developed in Netherlands under the auspices of Freudenthal with realistic mathematics education. It's not what is exactly developed in the Nordic countries. And so each of the partners comes to this project with its particular vision and culture about what could be inquiry-based education. And all these have some common principles, but they do not have the same hierarchy of sensitivities. And it was very interesting for us with Morten Blomage to reflect on this point. And so it's clearly understandable that when you have such a project at the beginning, you have a polyphony of voice coming from different cultures with different backgrounds. And if we want to communicate and share, you have to create some order in this polyphony of voice while respecting the diversity and the richness of this diversity. And for me, this was a big lesson of this project. So in this article, we have tried to consider different entrances to inquiry-based education. For instance, problem solving, which is a big entrance at an international level, but realistic mathematics education in Netherlands. Modeling approach, just in Germany, in Nordic countries, and Australia and others. Communities of inquiry, which are more recent approach developed. Critical approaches, as they exist in the Latin American world or in the Nordic world. Dialogic approaches, which are also diversely interpreted according to the country. Anthropological approaches, for instance, in France, has, and theory of didactic situation, something approaches are very strong in France. And all these shape, in some way, inquiry-based mathematics education and our vision. And finally, in order to consider, to summarize this, we introduced some things that we, methodologies that we had already used in networking work, research at in Europe. And so we consider that all these approaches were sensitive to more or less 10 concerns. But they did not express this concern in the same way. They did not give the same priority to these concerns. And here you have these concerns. The authenticity of question, the connection with students' with life and interest, the epistemological relevance of questions, the link with the curricular progression of knowledge, the role to be played by extra mathematical question and modeling processes, the experimental dimension of maths, the development of inquiry habits of mind, more generally, the autonomy, the sensitivity to the autonomy and responsibility given to the students, and the way the guiding role of the teacher is envisaged and the dialogic relationship in the classroom, and the collaborative dimension of the inquiry process, the critical and democratic dimension of IBMA. And if you see all these different approaches, they all consider these concerns, but with different orders of priority. And preparing this lecture, I was thinking about the vision of Varga of complex mathematics education, how it situates within this global picture, and that knowing how it can be situated is also a support in order to make this vision of education understandable by others and shareable with others. The second point, dissemination processes, which is a very crucial point, because we all know that we are able to succeed in local experiments in math education and science education. The problem is not the experimental situation, the problem is upscaling. And so, as I said, the first two projects had big dissemination ambitions. And the first call after the Rocard report pushed these dissemination goals. In Fibonacci, the main strategy was a twinning strategy. That is to say, Fibonacci started with 12 so-called reference centers. We were used at regional or national level to implement inquiry-based education in math and science or in both. And we had some responsibilities also, some activities for teacher education and professional development in that area. And these were twinned with 12 centers first who wanted to become reference center in their country. So the twinning was not between centers in the same country. Countries were crossed in the process. And then there were a progressive twinning process, 12, then 24, then 24 more along the process. At the end of the process, there were 62 centers involved. See, huge institutional things. And the dissemination strategy was peer learning through visits, a week visit, tutoring, sharing resources, and strategy transfer. And this was considered as key lever to broad and successful dissemination. This was a strategy. And also to this added a common work among the on five major topics, which was prepared within the consortium with the help of the scientific panel, and sharing two specific booklets that were constitute a common and shared base for all actions. And then there was also something, there were a lot of connection, extra school connection with museum organized also within this project. And there was a common project, which was the Green Wave project. All the partners and all the students involved and the teacher were looking at the progression of spring along the different countries in Europe, along the spring and the differences with and this was more about life science project, of course. In Primas, we have something which is in fact more classical because we have a cascade model based on the training of multipliers. And but it is very well thought, I would say. And so in order to implement and to develop this this model, there was a design-based research approach with successive cycles, several cycles during the 4 years of the project, leading to a flexible spiral model of inquiry-based professional development. And what is interesting is the way they, in this cycle, they think the combination between learning of jobs, that is to say in seminar action, learning on job when in classroom and reflecting then on that, and also for those multipliers, learning by doing the job of educating teachers under the supervision of a mentor. So there is a three form of learning, on job, off job, on job, by job. And there was also the development of shared resources, of course, both for classroom activities and teacher professional development, and a model which was adapted then to national context and implemented with the support of national consultancy panels. We had some power in order to make sure that things will be implemented. So some persons with political responsibilities were part of this national consultancy panel in order to make sure that things would work. So these two were, and if we look at the result of this dissemination strategy, we have evident quantitative results. For instance, at the beginning, as I said, in Fibonacci, the twinning strategy led to network 62 institutions in 25 countries. So you have all these phases of dissemination. They said that the final evaluation made by an independent body, external body, said that more than nearly 6,000 teachers have been touched and 300,000 students by Fibonacci actions over the first 3 years of the project. And the initial number target were already high because they said 2,500 teachers and 45,000 students, but these were widely outpassed. And in Primas, the partner engaged to educate 20 multipliers in charge of educating at least 100 teachers in each country of the partner, and more or less they succeeded, with some exceptions they succeeded in it. So you have these quantitative results, but quantitative result is not everything. And the reports, the data collected along the research the process show that there are strong discrepancies observed between the countries. That also is not easy to control the quality of the professional development actions, all the more as you have several stages of multipliers and so on. How to control is not easy. Even if you have good documents, good guides, how the guides are implemented is not so easy. And what was also clear with the evaluation at the end and all the questionnaire for teachers and students, that it was reasonably achieved to have change in teacher beliefs regarding inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education, and reaching a positive vision of inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education. But, and raising interest for that, and having parents agreeing also through specific action to this vision of education, which is not obvious at all, having parents adhering to that in many countries. But that generally it was very difficult to go beyond a very episodic implementation of such practice in classroom. So, and this was clearly a serious limitation of this project. And This was also raised new question, because in all the evaluation, both for Fibonacci and Primas, many teacher educator, researchers, and even policymakers said that, in fact, the usual forms of assessment used in classroom were a didactic obstacle to the implementation of inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education, because this assessment were often based on calculation, for instance, in math, rather routine tasks, maybe difficult, procedures, and not on very strong ideas and not something in line with inquiry-based learning and inquiry-based education. So this was, the origin of the project ASSISMI. And ASSISMI, in fact, was focused on assessment. And assessment in line, to find ways of assessing in line with inquiry-based education. And it was at the crossing of the culture researchers with the culture on inquiry-based learning and education and researchers with assessment culture, which was interesting. And there was a focus on formative evaluation, assessment, seeing that we have to develop formative assessment in the classroom. And I have no time to say everything, but they try to experiment to categorize different forms of formative assessment. They try to experiment these forms of assessment, four forms. They concentrated on four forms of formative assessment. They develop experimentation, in substantial experimentation, in different crossing the country, crossing the levels of schooling, crossing the discipline, and then they collect it and analyze all the results and all the data with joint case study analysis and joint analysis. And so it was also a very interesting project. And they developed shared criteria, and they pointed at some difficulties, some strategy more easier than others. The last thing I would like to mention is interdisciplinarity, world of work, cultural diversity and inclusion. So in MASKIL, and I invite you to look at the resource, for instance, for MASKIL, you have a lot of resources crossing the disciplines and also connecting in this resource, connecting with the world of work. You see, in all the resources, you have something which connects with the world of work. And you have even videos showing the world of work, interviews with professionals that help to enter, have the world of work entering the classroom. And this was really something interesting in MASKI. And we have also, you have also a lot of things that are developed for teacher education and not just for classroom, with a lot of resources for teacher education in different languages, not in Hungarian, because Hungary was not part of MASKIL. And MASDIV is the last and ongoing project. Here it's about inclusion, multiculturalism, and of course, for instance, in Germany, this is a pressing issue in education today due to the number of immigrants they have. And there is also another project, InclusMe, and many partners are both members of MASDIV and InclusMe. So, concluding remarks. So I would say we have had a multiplicity of projects of different types and scale. And what I was fearing at the beginning, but that does not seem to happen, there is a transfer and progression of knowledge, which is favored by the fact that partners are partly the same from one project to another, and always there are new partners. We have a coordination of an accumulation of coordinated action, experimentation, research, which allow us to better understand the possible ecology of inquiry-based education in our respective educational system. We have an impressive number of resources which have been developed, which are accessible online in different languages, both for the classroom and for teacher education. We have a better acknowledgement of the complexity of upskilling processes and strategy for that, and of the fact that the move towards IBU practice is a long-term process whose progression must be carefully accompanied. And also, what has been clear is the importance of promoting and supporting teacher collective work. Developing inquiry-based education is not a personal endeavor, it's a collective endeavor. And networking, and the necessity of getting support beyond the sole community, school community, for ensuring sustainable change. But I would say that we have also the evidence 10 years after that IBE is still the exception in the reality of classroom in most European countries, if not all. And my last side would be to advertise the new Center for Innovative Science Education, which will be inaugurated in Freiburg in next January, and which is built on the base of all these projects. Yeah. Thank you very much.